Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 5 of Rugby Nation. I'm Sean Maloney. This is Justin Harrison. And on the end of the desk today, Goog, we have got the one and only Beth Newman. Beth, you're on debut. So nice to have you here with us today.
Thanks for having me. I think Pato's in a bit of a chocolate coma, so had to step up today.
That's what happens when you've got kids across Easter. You're walking out the other side, type 2 diabetes, most likely.
What happens when they build chocolate bunny eggs bigger than you?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, Beth, it is great to have you with us, and it was an amazing weekend for Australian Super Rugby teams for the first time since 2006. Two Aussie Super Rugby sides successful over in the Republic. Beth, you're up for it. I know you caught both games. It was amazing. It was an amazing performance from both the Brumbies and the Reds.
Yeah, it's incredible to see. I mean, Australian teams have struggled a lot in South Africa the last few years, and even for the Reds, you know, over the last 15 years, they've not been able to win a game in Durban. So it's really a big tick for Australian rugby that they were able to get those wins.
I think you were even playing. I mean, this is how far back we're going, the last time that happened.
Black and white.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, look, I think it's we've stopped celebrating mediocrity. You know, we were expecting wins again, which is different to what we used to have in the rhetoric was only losing by a certain amount of points and thinking that was a positive tour. Now we're expecting to come home with some positive performances.
So things that have changed since 06, 13 years, there was no Facebook back then, I don't think, certainly no Spotify. Nice little production note here left by Pato. The guys wouldn't have been able to play Africa, which I would have celebrated with 2 bit of Toto on the Spotify. It didn't exist in 06.
Yeah, I think back then we had sort of karaoke machines. Bill Young liked to be a Milli Vanilli every now and then in his Y-front underwear, cocky singlet. But yeah, there certainly wasn't any social media going on, and thank goodness there wasn't.
Yeah, that's probably a good result for you blokes. I tell you what though, the guys that did celebrate via social media on the weekend, the Reds, too good for the Sharks. We'll start with those guys. The Reds strung together some amazing tries, Beth, off the back of Samu Karevi and a couple of others.
Yeah, Samu's playing incredible footy this year, and he really lifts the rest of that team. I mean, that win was such an important one for them. They're such a young team. Their pack particularly as well really stepped up. Harry Hooper in his first start. The Sharks were quite keen to turn down 3 points and target their scrum, but that pack didn't really let them do that, and that's how they kind of got the role, and it's exciting to see them, you know, get the reward.
Bryce Hegarty and Liam Wright, two guys who going into that game you wouldn't have thought would start, but Heggers goes through for the opening try, and Liam Wright a beast on the ball in that game.
Yeah, typically South African sides, you need your talisman to perform well, Samu Karevi did, and you need 3 or 4 support players to perform as well as what Samu has all year. I think that's what Queensland struggled to have. They've struggled to have the team galvanising around Samu and reading what he's trying to do. I thought one of the features of that game was the support play. When you're playing against the Sharks particularly, they want to get into a rhythm, play that sort of power South African game, kick for sideline, very big impacts, run straight at people. What Queensland did was use the ball very efficiently.
I couldn't believe how many errors that the Sharks made at the weekend. A lot of it came from the pressure created by the Reds. I get that. I also get that Tate McDermott's stocks have risen in terms of his Wallabies prospects. How far have they risen off the back of that performance at the weekend?
Every week he seems to be getting better, and he's one of those guys that probably not many people were talking about at the start of the year, but he's overtaken Moses Robbie there, and I mean that the competition for that second halfback spot behind Will Genia is so tight that, you know, maybe he could be rising up the ranks.
You like what you saw of Tate? Good yep. Name, isn't it? Tate.
Tate McDermott.
It's like a PR. Boxing name.
Or private investigator.
Yeah, maybe. Bit of both.
Yeah.
Probably. Former boxer, now PR. Tate McDermott.
Bring back Dan Crowley, the undercover.
The undercover from. What about Tate McDermott, the rugby player, though?
Rugby player's great. I think a lot of people can sniff now that Australian provinces are starting to perform across the board pretty equally. We're starting to see some great derby matches, which means that a Wallaby squad of 30 is going to get harder and harder to distinguish between. Halfback, you know, let's not count Will Genia as the first picked halfback possibly in the next couple of weeks if that sort of form keeps up.
Okay, that was Friday night. Saturday night, for those of us who stayed up, we were treated to a defensive masterclass from the Brumbies. Great start. 6 of their last 8 games in South Africa, they have come away as winners in. Why are they so good in the Republic? I mean, how do they do that at the weekend?
I think they probably play the way that not many Australian teams have over there. They're not afraid to grind it out. I mean, I think they had 224 tackles on the weekend. Rory Arnold had 24 of those on his own, and that's exactly the way you need to play in South Africa, is really, you know, grind it out and just be ready to hold out the opposition.
Who impressed you in that Brumbies win?
Oh, look, I think the forward pack were outstanding. You know, generally in South Africa, you've got to limit the space and time that South African players have with the ball. They love to be aggressive. They're not great decision makers under pressure. So you're 1, 2 and 3, you've got to get off the line and lead that line speed. 1, 2 and 3 are typically tight forwards either side of the ruck. So they generate a lot of the speed from inside out. They were outstanding. I thought they limited the time and momentum that any player had with the ball. Were able to cut them down quickly and nullify any sort of impact, which made it easier to make those tackles. That number sounds very daunting. Mm. Once you get into a bit of a rhythm in defence, it's actually easier to defend than it is to attack. Certainly I found that way anyway. I couldn't catch a cold, so I just thought I'd throw myself at people's legs the whole game. But and the other thing about the Brummies is, you know, let's not be afraid to win ugly. You know, you go there on a mission, you get points and you get out of there, and that used to be a common thread there for a while. And certainly the Brumbies look like they're starting to understand the sort of play that they need to switch between when they're away from home and at home.
Jerome Brown stepped in for Lachie McCaffrey. I know that you're a huge fan of Lachie McCaffrey. Jerome Brown, what can you tell us around where he's come from, Beth?
Yeah, well, he's from Waikato originally, I think, and come over, trained with the Brumbies in the pre-season, and they've just been really unlucky with injuries. I mean, Lachie McCaffrey, obviously Dave Pocock, but even Rob Valentini going down really hit their back row stocks hard, but Jerome really stepped up on the weekend, and it's a great thing for the Brumbies to have, given they've got their biggest names out and they're still able to be a force in that back row.
It's good, Jerome. And when we're speaking of good names, Jerome Brown with a J-A-H, Jerome Brown. Jerome Brown, at halftime, found himself in the sheds with the rest of the Brumbies team before they were all called back out. Now, this is one of the contentious moments around the game at the weekend. Can I get your... Actually, you know what? Should we just let Goog pull the trigger on this one? So, in the lead-up to halftime, there's 10 seconds to go. Pulu gets nailed for a seatbelt tackle. Everyone's off the field. They get called back on and ends up being a penalty try. Your thoughts, please, Justin Harrison.
Oh, verging on disappointing to ridiculous. You know, look, I think... Look, we've got to understand we're playing a violent game. We want to make it safer. But there's also some laws of physics where you cannot change trajectory once you're over tipping point. There are many instances where you can call back clean outs, you can call back any sorts, a lot of high ball catches, feet off ground, those sorts of things. If we start replaying every aspect of the game, we're going to bore people to tears and we're not going to stay in the living room. People are going to flick between the sport and go to something else that's more interesting.
Well, it did end up costing the Brumbies in the end, which is great for Brumbies fans and Stormers fans. Will they get to lick their wounds and regroup ahead of next week? The Sharks, we'll get to them in a second. They're on their way to Sydney to take on the Waratahs this weekend. Speaking of the Waratahs, they clash with the Rebels at the SCG Saturday night. Classic game of two halves, Beth Newman. Classic game of two halves.
Yeah, and I mean, the Rebels are no strangers to that sort of narrative in a game of footy, are they? They just seem to shut up shop in the second half, and the Waratahs just played them in that kicking game and eventually held them out, and Bernard Foley's second half as well, racking up, I think it was 16 points to get them over the line. Very impressive.
A lot of kicking in that game on Saturday night. Can you explain to the punter who's not so much across every minute of every Super Rugby game why that was a tactic?
Oh, look, I'm not a fan of kicking. I think it's just a turnover disguised as attack. But I think that when you have two evenly matched provinces, that clearly the Waratahs and Rebels are, two tens that are trying to stamp their mark on the game, they're probably trying to feel each other out. And like I said, defending is sometimes easier than attacking. So those two sides were very familiar with how they were going to attack, not so sure who was going to be more intense and more efficient in defence. So they sort of laid the trap, wait for an opportunity, and then pounce on it from there. I thought Quade Cooper was disappointing as well.
Okay. Who was impressive, though, in that matchup?
Foley. I thought Foley was great. The way he controlled his side. He's been criticised in the past for not being a dominant character in the back line and been overshadowed by his outside backs. I thought that all of the language looked like it was generating from inside and heading out, and he was steering that shit very well.
We spoke about this in the lead-up last week, Beth, that you've got these guys going at it for Wallaby spots, and it lifts the tempo and the skill set to that next step up. Who else do you think put the hand up in that game on Saturday night at the SCG?
I think looking at that whole Waratahs backline structure, you probably see some guys putting their hands up. Kirtley Beale at that fullback position, he just looks so comfortable at the back there. He fielded a lot of high balls, and the Rebels seemed to really try and target him, but he did it really well. And I mean, he played 15 off the bench at the World Cup last time, and there's no reason he can't do it again.
Speaking of 15s, how did Hodgie go? Reece Hodgie go at 15?
Yeah, industrious, but didn't seem to be as comfortable as what Kirtley looked. didn't seem to be as comfortable as 15s that are in high intensity games. You know, I thought that, you know, you've got to think about those players. If they're in a quarter final, comes down to the last 5 minutes in a World Cup situation, who do you want on the field taking high balls, Kirtley or Rees? Foley directing traffic or Quade Cooper missing kicks in general play? Starts to get interesting.
Okay, righto. Well, it was, as we said, a match that swung heavily off the back of halftime. The Tars were down 20 points to 3 before rattling home to win 23 points to 20. And I guess the broader picture around this is the fact that now that Aussie conference is blown wide open, Beth. Wide open.
Yeah, and this is a trend we're seeing across Super Rugby. You mentioned the Sharks before. They looked like the best team in South Africa 3 weeks ago, and now they're struggling and need to get a win on tour to keep their season alive. And the Aussie teams, the Brumbies, I think, are now within striking distance of that top spot, the Waratahs as well. Even the Reds are still in the mix. So it's, you know, it's hard to do your picks every week, that's for sure.
Brumbies Jaguars this week, that could be interesting. Tars Sharks.
Yeah, Jaguars are a great side, clearly benefiting from having their national side playing a Super Rugby season as well as Test Rugby.
We don't see or hear a lot of the Jaguares, do we?
No, we don't. We sort of, we might hear the love-in bromance between Mario Ledesma and Stephen Larkham again. Snore. Look, the other thing is we got to be careful, you know. We probably, South African sides look like they might be easy pickings in this Super Comp this year, and then we'll get a slap in the face when we come up against the New Zealand side. So let's not sprint before we can walk.
Well, there won't be any Kiwi opposition for the Aussies this week, but just still with the Jaguares, great point you make, Beth, that they smoked, was it the Bulls a couple of weeks back, put 50 on them. So you just don't know, you don't know what's going to roll out week to week now, especially at this
time
of year.
They smoked the Sharks too at Shark Park, didn't they?
Yeah, I think
Kings
they made
Park,
Yeah, so they're a bit of smacking, the Jaguares.
I was always more interested in the car park party, but...
Smacking the car park?
Well, not smacking anyone, smacking a few beers, probably.
Sure, okay.
That was nice.
Right, well, they did do that when they were over there jagging that win. So they'll be a tough opposition this week for the Brumbies.
Yeah, absolutely. They're just so unpredictable, I think. And as you mentioned, they've got a lot of test players, so coming in and out of that side every week, with, you know, heading into the World Cup, and a few guys that aren't there this year that have been in the past as well. So They're always dangerous, and particularly in Buenos Aires, they're such an unpredictable opposition and really, really tough to beat.
It's like the world's longest trial game period for the World Cup. They've got their national coach coaching, like, you know.
Which means they'll be good. Well, they'll be good in 2015.
They'll be overcooked.
They made the semis.
Yeah, then they fainted, lost focus, carried on.
They'll good in 2007.
Greatest team alive against Ireland, like Ireland do every time before they head into a World Cup.
Yeah, but Argentina made the semis.
Can't believe it. This is the greatest day of my life. I'm going to make. No, you're not going to make it.
What are you quoting there? Oh, he's leaping on Springfield George.
Yeah.
Springfield George as well as Springfield George. Who's Springfield George?
I don't know. That's a good name for a rugby player.
There might be a Springfield George.
The halfback for the Jaguars.
There might be a Springfield George out at Bankwest Stadium this week. So, guys, this week's flashback, look forward, is around new stadiums. It's going to be amazing out at Parramatta. If you haven't bought tickets yet, do, especially if you're in that part of the world. We saw Parra up against the West Tigers across the weekend in rugby league, jam-packed. Should be a decent crowd this week as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think anyone who watched that game on Monday will be so excited to get a chance to go out and see the Tars play out there. The stadium, after, you know, three times of watching footy at the SCG, when you're so far away from the action, this stadium, you're basically getting vertigo if you're on the top row, because it's that close to the field. So it'll be exciting, and the first night game as well, I think. So yeah, it'll be exciting for that entertainment side of it as
well. So the Sharks will be their opposition out west this weekend, the Tars. But good, let's go through some of the great stadium opening rounds situations for the particular ground, then the matches that have followed out. So let's go Allianz Stadium, which is being demolished as we speak. Opened 88. The first two test matches there were in 89 for the Wallabies. They took on the Lions. Your recollections of the third and final?
Of that one?
Of that series.
In 89?
Correct.
None. I wasn't watching rugby back then.
Okay.
I was busy staying alive in the Northern Territory. I was brought up there. So,
okay. Yeah. Should I jump in for you?
I do remember that they
it's
lost.
Only the most iconic miss pass in the history of probably Australian rugby.
Mate, I lost the series. I do remember seeing those.
Yeah, okay. It was Campo and Marto getting it.
As I was reminding him that I won the series.
Campo and Marto getting it mixed. Oh, because you won it in 2001.
Apparently.
That's never been mentioned.
That's the mail.
That's never been mentioned. Suncorp Stadium. 2003, test match between Australia and South Africa. I think you may have played in that one. Aussies win 29-9.
Yeah, I probably did. We won.
I just told you you won. But
yeah, I know.
Did you
play just means it? I probably did.
Yeah, okay.
No, I don't actually remember that game. I do remember, however, Suncorp Stadium, one of the last good stinks in world rugby, which happened to involve myself and Jeremy Paul, Ben Tune, Cornet Krieger, and a bloke called Farn Ruttenbuck, right? And so we get into this knuckle, yellow cards everywhere, reds for a few. And afterwards at the tribunal hearing on the Sunday, I'm outside talking to Ruttenbuck, so how about that? Yeah, geez, hope we get off, no problem having it. You know, when's your flight back? Rhubarb, rhubarb. We head into the hearing and the tribunal says, okay, so Farn, you go first. Can you explain your actions here? And he says, I don't speak English. I speak Afrikaan. That's it. And I had to explain the whole thing. So I got suspended.
Well, and he got off.
He got off.
Can you give the ultimate hospital pass. Yeah,
Farn Ruttenbuck.
That's a good Afrikaans name.
Yeah, sounds like a full drive, doesn't it?
ANZ Stadium, 1999, 28-7, win over the All Blacks. 107,042 in attendance. From memory, that was a Rod Kafer masterclass.
Who won?
Aussies.
Did they?
Yeah.
Oh.
It was the biggest ever defeat handed to the All Blacks, 28-7.
Right.
And then off to the World Cup for a win.
Yeah, no, I don't remember that. Oh, I might have. Actually, I went to that game. I did go to that game. I was a fan of CAFE back then. I'm not now, but I was back then. And yeah, that was a great game.
MVP. And then lastly, 2011, Tars v Rebels at Amy Park. 43-0 in front of 25,000.
I remember they that beat game. The Brums a week later. By
they
a point.
Did. I do remember that. That
Danny
was...
Cipriani, just Google me, kicked a penalty goal to win the game.
That's
after Celesi Mafu pushed a guy in the in the face, one of the props.
You pulled that one.
And
nice.
The referee was.
How do you know this?
The little
so
shopping
well?
Genius. What's his name?
The shopping genius.
And it'll come to me. And we met him. This is what put an end to coaches. I was coaching. We met him the day before, just to get a read on how his refereeing style was. No problem. We'll get into it. And he penalised us at the end of the game. Never met another referee after that.
Shopping. I want to know who it was.
What's his name? He was on a shopping trip. We saw him with all his Gucci bags and stuff.
Jeez, I wouldn't mind being a ref if you're picking up some Gucci gears. From Gucci to Kitakushu, where the Aussie women's seven side struggled across the weekend, lost to Canada in the pool rounds, and then lost to England. This quarter's result really surprised me because Australia have had the edge over England for a long time. What went wrong in Kitakushu? I know you were across each and every one of those games, Beth.
Yeah, well, they looked good on that first day, but the second day they just were a little bit out of sorts. And it seems to be a trend with the women now that if they don't have possession, they really struggle to make an impact. Their defence is a little bit patchy. They miss a few tackles and then teams can really pile points on them. And that's what happened against England and also against New Zealand. That just they kept collecting their own restarts and scoring against them.
New Zealand stay top of the pops for the moment. Australia still in fourth position after Canada went on to win that title in Kitakushu. Well done to Jazane Landry and the rest of the gang. So they're still in that fourth position, the Aussie women's seven side, which is key, as we've touched on. That will qualify them automatically for the Olympics next year. And still with Aussie action, the Junior Wallabies kick off at Oceania Under-20s on Friday nights against Japan. Isaac Lucas will feature. Do you know what I'm happy about? I see some of the names that have been good in Super Rugby for a long time all playing for the Aussie 20 side. Last year, it was a bit of a mess. You had an Aussie 20 situation over in France where they were deprived of the likes of Jordan Patea and a bunch of other guys. This time around, they're all playing in the 20s.
Yeah, well, they've actually introduced a bit of a benchmark now for guys. If they don't play enough minutes, they don't have the rights to them in Super Rugby anymore. So, yeah, you're not going to have a situation like that. It's very clear cut, and it's good for the 20s, as you said.
And just on that, part of the reason why this speaks to me as a fan, it speaks to guys like George Gregan as well, who says that part of the reason that you guys enjoyed your success at a Wallaby level was because guys like Greggs and a bunch of other fellas played against New Zealand at a 20s stage, or 21s it was back then, got used to beating them, got used to playing against those guys. There was no mental scars, and as a result, they carried that forward, and look at the results.
Yeah, it's a national jersey. It's got to take precedence over a super match, particularly if you're not playing many minutes or you're coming off the bench. But, you know, this is an Australian representative jersey, and every age group needs to be given an opportunity to put their best team on the field. And you're right, you end up playing against the age group players later on in Test rugby. You know, Greggs played ACT under 21s, was selected in the Australian 21s, but then was picked in the Wallabies that year and went through. Joe Roth, similar, under 19s, under 21s, all the way through against the Anton Olivers and Tane Randalls of the world. So Stephen Larkin couldn't make the team. He was a halfback back then.
He would have been the world's tallest halfback.
Yeah, and the world's worst as well. You used to look at the team sheet, and if he was picked at 9, there would be visible disappointment in the team room. So, Bernie's playing again. Well, he wasn't called Bernie back then. He was just Stephen Larkham, the dork.
When did he shift from being Dork Larkham to Bernie Larkham?
Well, when he got his face ground off at the Manuka pitch playing halfback from going himself again, he got thrown into the cricket pitch at Manuka Oval. He decided halfback's not for me, and we all thought, great idea. We think Waterboy's better. But he transitioned into 12, 13.
And when did the nickname come, Bernie?
He went on a tour of the Victorian side in 1994 with the OCT Kookaburras, didn't say a word for 10 days, came back Bernie from Weekend at Bernie's.
Great movie and a great episode of Rugby Nation. We have rattled through this, guys. It's been great, Beth, having you in here. A quality injection, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's got to keep feeding Pato chocolate.
I think that's the key. Give him as much chocolate as you can. Beth Newman, thank you for your time. Gug, as always, great to have you here with us, and great to have you with us dialed in as well on Rugby Nation. Don't forget all the games across the weekend. Waratahs v Sharks, the whole box and dice, Brumbies v Jaguars, 8 a.m. on Sunday morning. Catch it on Fox Sports, and we will catch you again same time next week.